Hey, good morning, Abundant Life Church family. We are so glad that you are here with us today. We welcome you to Abundant Life online service, and you're going to have a great day. Happy Father's Day to all the dads watching today. Thank you for taking time to take in the Word of God, to worship with your family. Thank you for leading your family and following Jesus. We're out here at the Fort Golf Course. Just loving life, loving the thinking of Father's Day. There's many dads going to take a round of golf in, and we're glad that we can come to you out here at in beautiful Lawrence. The landscape, the greenery, it's always beautiful to get out. I love the inspiration that I personally enjoy from just taking in a round of golf, and so it's one of my joys in life to play. I heard that Dr. Billy Graham was an avid golfer, and that he played as oft as he could, and he played a lot and he was good. And so I don't know that to put myself in the category of Billy Graham is never very wise, and I'm sure he was a much better golfer. I'm a big sinner when I play golf, because the word for sinner means to miss the mark. And when I play golf, I miss the mark often, but I'm grateful for grace, grateful for the forgiveness of God, and glad that you would join us here on this, the Lord's Day. So happy Father's Day. If you're watching on YouTube or you're watching on Abundant Life Live, please share the broadcast with others. Thank you for those who have participated to upload a greeting to your dad and to give us some opportunities to honor fathers today. So thanks for your help. We want to pray and believe God as our worship team joins us now to lead us in worship. I want to say thanks for your giving. You can give online. You can still send money into the church. You can bring your offering if you come live with us. We're meeting outdoors. If it rains, we're indoors. But we're grateful. God's moving. We're grateful for the presence of the Lord. We're grateful for the provision of God in your life and in mine. We pray for the protection of God over our city, over our land. We pray for humility in our hearts, and that we fight this battle against racism, that God will take what was meant for evil and turn things around for good. And we believe that about our God. He's getting our attention. We believe that the church is praying. We believe that he's clothing us with humility, and we're excited about the future of what God's doing before Jesus comes back. So join me in praying today. Lord, thank you. Thank you that we can honor fathers. Thank you for the men who love Jesus. Thank you for the men of God. We pray for every household, every home, every dad, every father. We pray for the blessing of God upon their life. Lord, we want to be a man of God. We want to learn what it is to act like the man that you created us to be. So Lord, pour out your spirit, pour out your blessing as the worship team leads us in worship. Lord, we're grateful. We're grateful for the cross. We're grateful for your presence. We're grateful that Jesus is the King, and we lift our hearts in worship. Come on, join in today. Give God some thanks. Give him some praise. He's worthy of it all. Amen.
Hallelujah. You have made, whatever comes, I won't complain. For all my hope is in your name, and now your joy awaits my praise. Come on, help me sing. I give thanks, all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love, your love. Set my feet on the higher ground. So here I stand. You are my God. Your faithfulness, my solid rock. Oh, I give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy. Lord, I'm your love is compelling. Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all you have done. I won't forget all the battles you have won. Your love is compelling. Lord, I am grateful. Oh,
hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands with me this morning. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our life declare the love our God has spoken over us. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our lives declare the love our God has spoken over us. Come on, give thanks. I give thanks for all you have done.
Praise.
have surrendered to the mighty cross of Jesus Christ, the earth would shake beneath the weight of darkened skies. On his brow a crown of sorrow, for a king whose weakness was our strength.
Love. Our dad, Ed Markham, is an awesome person. He is passionate, and he is also caring.
He's also really competitive, and he's dedicated.
He's tall, and he's handsome. My dad is nice.
Incredible. I love everything about my dad, and I realize more as I've gotten older and I've become a parent what a gift it really is to have an amazing dad who's there for you no matter what.
How old is Pops?
36.
Probably one of the kindest, most gentlest, graceful people I know.
He's a very hard worker. Just had his 90th birthday and still was talking about working 6 days a week last week and over 50 hours. So he's been very blessed with his health, and we've been very fortunate to have him around as long as we have. And
he's the boss of the restaurant.
And how old is your daddy?
2 years old.
My daddy is snuggly and funny. My dad is smart and handsome.
Well, I know that he's funny, and I know that he likes to go to fishing, and I know that he said I can have an apple. I know that he's really funny.
Do you like to mow the yard?
Yeah.
What else?
Play with toys.
What I love to do most with my dad, aside from coaching with him, is we love to go to concerts and listen to music together.
My favorite thing to do with him is to go to different MLB stadiums and go to any game that we can.
Watch movies and snuggle up. And watch mommy sitting on the couch.
My favorite thing to do with dad is to go fishing with him and watching TV with him. My favorite thing is going up to breakfast with him and doing a dance party.
I love getting to be able to go on dates with you sometimes, and when we try out new restaurants in the area that you've heard of, and I love hearing all your stories from your Uber experiences and golfing. And most of all, I love your heart after God, and that you lead by example, and that you've showed me what to look for in a potential mate, and that you treat mom so well. You treat Sis and I and the girls like you're just the most genuine, loving person.
My favorite thing to do with you is snuggle with you, and when you read the Bible to me, I love that.
I like to go to the donut store and get some donuts with him. Go to the donut place and get some donuts.
Our favorite memory is obviously winning state, woo! As a player and as a coach.
And my favorite memory is when you read that one devotional to me 2 weeks ago or 2 months ago.
I remember as we were growing up, my dad was always there. It didn't matter if it was celebrating with making green eggs and ham at home, or going to my sister's basketball games, or even now as an adult, just that he's here to help me start the grill, or to come and watch the girls for a few hours, or to go to lunch with me at the last minute.
I like going fishing with him, and I like riding my bike with him, and I like when he catches me.
What I've learned from my dad is God's love, commitment, and dedication.
My favorite memory of my dad is when we were sleeping in the tent and when I first met my dad.
What's your favorite memory of dad?
My favorite memory is riding bikes with him and when he looks at him, and I like going fishing with him.
I love that you're always up for an adventure. Some of my favorite memories have been going on vacations with you, or trips, or when you came to London and Paris with us. That was a great time, and that you always are willing to take the road less traveled to try and find a new adventure for us.
I love you, Daddy.
Love you, Dad.
Love you.
Thank you for everything.
I love you.
Love you, Daddy.
Blow kisses. Charlie, say I love you, Daddy.
Love you, Daddy.
Dad, love you. Thank you for everything. Happy Father's Day.
Do you love your daddy?
Mm-hmm.
How much? Can you show me how much?
All the kisses.
You love him all the kisses. Can you blow him a kiss?
I love you so much, and I hope you have a great Father's Day.
I love you.
Love you, Dad. Love you, Dad.
What I love the most about my dad is that he is literally always there. If I need something, I can call him. I can depend on him. I know that he's going to be that voice of reason for me if I just need to talk, or if it's an emergency and I just got in a car accident, I know I can call him and he'll be on his way. And I just love my dad so much, and I hope that you always remember that and know that your family thinks you are incredible, as well as a lot of other people. And I'm just really blessed and thankful that God chose me to be your daughter, and that we all get to be part of your family, because you really are an incredible dad and an incredible man. And I hope you feel blessed today on Father's Day.
Wow. Isn't the Lord wonderful? Man, I'm so grateful for the presence of God when we open up our hearts in worship. Listen, if you're local, if you live local, we're honoring dads. We've got gift cards. If you'll do hashtag Father's Day on our online format, we'll send you a gift card for Luciana's Mexican restaurant. If you live local. If you live elsewhere, well, you let us know if you're coming our way. We'll take you there ourselves, amen, and treat you to some great Mexican food. Praise God. If you have your Bible, I'm interrupting. I've got the scripture verse in here that has the word stand firm in our faith in it. So it kind of fits with our series on stand firm. But I'm really talking to dads today. I'm really talking to us men. I really want to address this as Mother's Day. I talked about resilient moms. Well, today I've got a message that's entitled, Act Like Men. Now, I'm not saying play acting. I'm just saying, men, we got to man up. We got to learn from one another. And I think God has something to say to us today. So here's the scripture verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, 13, 14 says, be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong. Let all that you do be done in love. Lord, I thank you for the word of God today. Let it speak to our hearts. Anoint lips of clay. Lord, touch us, form us, do a mighty work. In Jesus' name, amen. In our culture today, this admonition of Paul could not be more timely and needed to be heard today than perhaps any other time in history. We are in a war against the ideals, the values that are being espoused by institutions, by the media, by our educational system, by our judicial systems, by our political systems. And all of these together have the potential to undermine the basic foundations of faith and family. We need men who are like men of Issachar, who understood their times. In Chronicles 12:32, it says that 200 leaders and their families understood their times and knew the best course to take for Israel's future. That's the kind of men that we need right now in America, and really globally across the world, that men who rise up, understand the times, and understand what it's going to take us from where we are to where we need to go. Proverbs says this, give instructions to a wise man and he will be wiser still. Teach a righteous man and he will increase in learning. Come on, let's learn from one another. Let's admit that we don't know it all. Let's admit that we can learn from different people, different backgrounds, different races. We can learn and we can embrace one another. And we have a God in heaven who's able to pull us all together and unite our hearts as one. Paul's words to the church at Corinth, act like men, need to be heard and understood by the 21st century men. I don't know what they were up against in the first century entirely, but I do know there was great confusion going on around them. I know that there's great confusion going on in our country about what it means to be a man. Men are struggling not to slip into superficial, self-indulgent secularism. I was reading a book by author James McDonald. He writes this, men are in deep trouble. Every statistic says that most men are somewhere between dabbling on the edges of self-disqualifying, self-destructive sin, or actually walking and wading right into it. In fact, the five main areas where men spend their money are this, electronics, sports, cars, gambling, and alcohol. All of these are clues to a self-centered perspective. Men are struggling, stumbling, and proving weak in the face of temptation. The rampant spread of internet porn is devouring men's souls like a new and deadly form of cancer. I serve in the district committee to interview young ministers coming up in our fellowship, and oftentimes I don't ask them any longer, have you ever viewed porn? I say, when was the last time? In other words, I assume that by intent or by accident, they viewed it, their eyes have seen it. Now I'm saying to them, and we bring that up, we confront it head on because we want to say, what are you doing to keep that stuff out of your life so that you don't lose your way, you don't lose your relationship, you don't lose the moral fiber of what it is to be a act like a man according to God's purpose and God's plan. What is the solution to some of these pandemic problems that are more deadly than the coronavirus? The coronavirus might take your health, but this will rob your soul. I know this, as goes the man, so goes the family. The solution for every man is to become the man of God you were created to be. For every man to have their life transformed by God and to take steps toward living out God's calling on their life. It's my prayer that every man, including me, will be a man of God, the man that God created me to be. So here's what I wanted to get to. I know this. As goes the man, so goes the family. As goes the man, so goes the church. As goes the man, so goes the community. As goes the man, so goes the nation. Men, we need you to know what it means like to act like men. I need to know it. These two verses that I read earlier, they are perfect instructions for men. Come on. How many of you guys, when you get something to put together, you first just get it all out and you kind of just go for it, and then you might go back and read the instructions if you get stuck, but you're going to start maybe by just kind of tackling it, especially if the instructions are too wordy. Now, if they're quick, short-term instructions, you may read it and go, okay, I can do that. I got it. And so these two verses are kind of that way. They're geared for us, man. They're just short imperatives, five short, to the point imperatives, quick instructions that a man can understand. And since most men don't like to read, if each one of us can lay hold of these five things and put them into practice, I think we'll do well. He says to be watchful, stand firm in the faith, be strong in everything, do it in love, and act like men. So today I want to give you four things not to do, because sometimes in order to know what to do, to be the man God wants us to be, we got to know what not to do, what not to be. And then I'll give you four things that are positives that'll be takeaways for today. So you with me? Four things, first of all, that it takes to act like a man. Four things not to do, all right? The first one is don't act like a woman. Come on. You know, in other words, obvious, right? I've been married 39 years, and I'm a big fan of women, especially my wife. I should say woman, singular. Although, I'm grateful for all the women in our world, aren't you? And I'm glad that Debbie's put up with me for 39 years. She's added so much to my life She is an answer to my prayers. That's right. I prayed for Debbie. I prayed for her. First, I prayed for a wife, not knowing who I was praying for, but knowing that it wasn't going to be good for me to be alone, right? God said to Adam, Adam, it's not good for you to be alone. So I embraced that early on. I said, yeah, that's right, Lord. You know who I am. I need a lot of help. And so God gave me an answer to my prayer. When I met Debbie, I fasted and I prayed for a while in order before I asked her to marry. I'm so glad she said yes. And she's brought so much joy, so much value to my life. And so maybe you understand that God's saying, you know what? It's not good for you to be alone. I would say for the majority of people, God's going to design you to be married. In the beginning, you know, Adam and Eve, they were a couple, they were a family. Not everybody. Obviously, the Apostle Paul said, I wish some of you would be like me and not marry. But for most of us, it's going to be married. You know, men and women are equal under God in every way, but we are not the same. Hey, my name's Peter. I'm here to help you. Right? We're not the same. Every cell in our body, every cell in their body is different. Right? You know, and typically men have a little more strength. Women have a little more sensibility about intuitive type things. Women have a different emotional makeup than men. Not to say that men aren't emotional at all, just that we're different that way. Women are touched by things that men think are silly sometimes. You know, I sometimes will get tickled by a few people I know that when I have a conversation with them, I always think, do I need the Kleenex box nearby? Because I'm pretty sure there's going to be some tears involved. I can cry sometimes. I get moved on by the Holy Spirit. I can weep over things. True. But I don't cry over a lot of things. Women are different. Women in general need their man to be a source of stability and strength and leadership. You know, the major decisions, responsibilities for your home are on you, man, not your wife. They're your call. We men should listen to our wives, learn from her, and don't fail to lead her. By the way, I sent this message to my wife, got her approval on it before I preached this. So just FYI, I got Debbie's sign off on what I'm sharing with you. Men are called to lead with love, with service, and with tenderness. Acting like a man means you lead. Men are made to provide security for their wives. Men are designed to provide strength and protection for their wife and their family. Some authors wrote it this way: men are like buffaloes and women are like butterflies. Now picture it out on a nice pasture. You know, this is not a pasture. This is a manicured golf course. But picture a buffalo out grazing, right? And they're eating and they're just moved and the wind's howling. He weighs 2 tons. It don't matter how hard that wind's blowing. He's strong. He's a buffalo. He's just out there grazing. That little butterfly fluttering around, though, it's feeling every little current of the wind. The butterfly has to kind of inform the buffalo when it's getting really severe weather or sorts. You see what I'm saying? There's a benefit. We're different. We have different strength. We need to be helped by the ability to be able to feel those little currents of what's going on around about us. And sometimes then the butterfly, the women in our life, they need the stability of the strength that can be provided by someone who just is going to, you know what, whatever we're standing against, whatever's coming at us, we're going to make it through. That's the buffalo in us. The main direction of life, the place chosen by the Lord when it comes to Debbie and I's life, the call on our life has primarily been mine to lead in consultation with Debbie. She has helped me to discern the process and determine the timing and the place where God was leading us together. It flowed down from our Heavenly Father, but it came to me first through prayer, through just listening, and then I would share it. Sometimes Debbie wouldn't have a real positive response initially to what it was that I was sensing in my life. So sometimes I would have to go back to the prayer closet and say, well, God, if this is something you really want, we got to do this together. You're going to have to speak it to her heart and to her life too. So there was wisdom, there was guidance. But the first step when we ever have made a shift, a change, a major location, whether it was from Springfield after we got married to our first place of ministry in Peoria, from Peoria to Indianapolis, whenever those things transpired, I would hear from God. I would share it with Debbie. We'd begin to pray, and then we would discern the will of God. There's a flow. There's a leadership. And listen, guys, when you lead on your knees, when you lead with a heart after God, you build trust with your wife. When it works out and they sense that they're in the will of God, then they have more and more confidence that, hey, you know, maybe this guy can hear from God. There is a God in heaven who does help us. And so don't act like a woman, act like a man, right? Second thing is don't act like an animal. We lead with consideration of how our actions will impact others. Animals, they don't care. We used to have a Dalmatian, a dog, we named it Pongo, right? From 101 Dalmatians. And his nickname was the Spotted Antichrist, because that dog's spirit never was right. That dog caused me more heartache and hardship and embarrassment because it was an animal. Men, we're not to act like these dogs. We're not animals. We don't act that way. That dog, it would get out of the house. It would be an escape artist. The door would open. The kids were little. They couldn't stop him. Next thing you know, Pongo's out. He's up peeing on somebody trying to come to church. He got in the one time and took a bite out of a wedding cake. Somebody came in our house. He bit him in the behind. I mean, that dog spirit never was right. Don't act like an animal. We act like men when we put other needs ahead of our own, right? That dog never could figure that out. We're not animals. So we don't act like animals. We don't act like women. Third thing is we don't act like a boy. We don't act like a child. The love chapter says, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. I thought as a child. I reasoned as a child. But when I became a man, I put off childish things. You know, Debbie and I have two wonderful daughters and three granddaughters. And I'm always amazed. Maybe it's been a little while because, our kids are grown. So, but we're remembering this now with our grandchildren of how quickly a child can go from everything's great, everything's wonderful, you're having a wonderful time, they're laughing, they're having fun, they're playing safely, and then in a moment's notice, it can turn for a child, and it can be total uproar, anarchy, to crying and demanding something of you in just a matter of seconds. It's like, what just happened here? Well, they've not yet discovered that the whole world does not revolve around them. They don't know that yet. A child doesn't learn that. Men, don't act like a child, like the whole world has to revolve around you. You know, we need to grow into our man. Acting like a man means you develop a non-anxious presence that remains calm in a crisis and does not panic under pressure. Godly men don't respond. They respond, they don't react. You got that? They respond, they don't react. Most of us have learned this by our failures. Those times when we reacted in the moment rather than responding with patience and kindness. Those failures are what God uses to teach us how to stop acting like a boy and becoming a man. So we're not going to act like a woman. We're not going to act like an animal. We're not going to act like a child. And finally, we're not going to act like a superhero. Having strength and stability does not mean that we don't feel things deeply or struggle with our own insecurities. None of us are Iron Man or Superman. James 3:2 says this, we all stumble in many ways. In other words, the perfect man does not exist except for the one, the Christ, the Messiah. He was perfect, the rest of us are not. God is the one who has to help us admit our failure, admit our weak areas. You know, even Superman, he had a weak area, right? Kryptonite could remove all those superpowers from him. Well, we all have something that even though we have strengths, we also have areas where we're weak. And sometimes we fail to act like men if we fail to admit that we are weak and need the strength that God wants to provide for us. The Apostle Paul experienced that. I mean, he's a mighty man of God, right? But there was a time where he experienced God just as he prayed, Lord, take this thorn, take this thing from me. And what was the answer that he got? He said, Paul, my grace is sufficient. My power can be on display in your life, even through your weakness. And so he said, I'm going to glory in my weakness so that the excellency of the power will be of God and not of ourselves. And so we have to learn that, man. We're not going to act like a woman. We're going to lead by the strength God gives us. We're not going to act like an animal. We're going to be sensitive to the things that are going on around about us. We're not going to act like a child. We're going to grow up into the manhood that God has for us. And fourthly, we're not going to act like we're a superhero and that we don't need help in becoming the man that God has for us. We're going to lean in to the heart of our Father. Those are four things we're not going to do. Now, what are we going to do? Well, Paul answers that. He said, we're going to act like men. We're going to be watchful. We're going to be on alert. We're going to be sensitive to the atmosphere in our home. When something's off a little bit, when there's tension, when there's strife, we're going to be watchful about the little foxes that maybe are trying to come in. Maybe we're missing spending good time with our family. Chase and I were talking earlier about how sometimes in his life that his dad worked 96 hours a week sometimes. So, you know, as a child growing up, most kids spell love T-I-M-E. And so if you miss out on that, sometimes we got to be watchful and be aware, when does my wife need the time that I need to spend with them so that we're watchful. We're not allowing, because Satan goes around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And so we're watchful because we don't want to let anything in that the enemy's trying to do to take us out. See, it matters when we say, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. The devil puts a target on us and says, well, let's just see if we can take this family out. If we can cause friction, we can cause their marriage to crumble. If we can throw something at them and scheme something that would undermine this family. Because God's counting on the family. Listen, your family, your ability to love your wife as Christ loves the church and her follow your leadership is a beautiful picture of Christ's love for that he has for the bride of Christ. And so it's a living, each family, each man, each wife is meant to be a living parable, a living picture of what God's love relationship is with his bride, the church that he bought with his price. So in Peter, it says this, for you are a chosen people. You're a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God for the called out ones that you are out of darkness into his marvelous light. He says, once you had no identity as a people, but now you have an identity. Once you had received no mercy, now you have received mercy. Then he says, dear friends, I warn you as temporary residents and foreigners to keep away from worldly desires that wage war against your very soul. So we got the enemy from without, the devil going about like a roaring lion. But then we have this war of our soul within that we got to keep on guard and know that we have an identity in Christ. We've been bought with a price. We belong to God. We're a people showing forth the praise of God out of our darkness into light. And that's how we learn to live. So that's the first thing, is that we are watchful for the war that's going on without and within. The second thing that we have to do on a positive note is we stand firm in our faith. He says, you are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who believe and are saved. Declare today, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. We're going to believe. We're going to trust. We're not going to let go of faith. We've laid hold of it. Now, men, listen. Sometimes we go, well, I believe, but I'm struggling. That's all right. Your faith is forged in those tests and trials. You say, well, I don't have, see, feel like I got much faith. Well, listen, if you have just mustard seed, you got little faith in a big God. What faith you do have, God's given you a measure of faith, and that faith's going to grow. What you have now, it's a fruit. It's going to grow. It's a gift from God that sometimes you just know that you know because God gifts it to you. You know this is right. You know this is the way, and you just go with it. There's other times you have to grow into it, and you grow into it by not letting loose of it. You grow into it by just keeping hold of it. You grow into it by just having one victory. You go, wow, I did this according to the word. When I did it, I got this result. That builds your faith. Some of you, when you've learned to tithe, when you learned to trust God with your money, and all of a sudden you began to give in a way that was first a challenge to you. But as you did it, you learned that, wow, God does multiply seed to the sower. I don't know how he did it, but he did it. Because he's faithful and your faith grows. So stand firm right in your faith. Then he says, be strong and courageous, for the Lord your God will be with you and go everywhere that you go. I've already talked a little bit about that, right, in the previous section. So I'm not going to say a lot about it, but our strength is in God. My hope is in the Lord. My strength is in the Lord Jesus Christ. When I'm weak, he makes me strong. So Be strong and courageous. Stay the course. Fourth thing is do everything in love. Love wins, right? The love chapter. 1 Corinthians 13. It says love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. So what are you saying, Pastor? Well, I'm saying don't act like we're gonna act like men. We're not gonna act like a woman. We're not gonna act like an animal. We're not gonna act like a child. We're not gonna act like a superhero. We're just gonna act like a man of God, standing strong, standing firm in our faith, watchful, prayerful, sober, aware. And we're gonna move forward trusting the love of God, knowing that He loves us at our best. He loves us when we blow it. He loves us when we come home frustrated. He loves us when our kids are on our last nerve. He loves us no matter what we're going through. He loves us through pandemics. He loves us through racial tensions. He loves us through it all, and He's here to help us. And I'm here to call you today, men, we need you. As the man goes, so goes the family. As the man goes, so goes the community. As the man goes, so goes the church. As the man goes, so goes the nation. It's time that men rise up, fill their place, act like men in pursuit of God our Father. And the beauty of it is He's going to help us. I don't know where you might be as you've tuned in this broadcast today. I just want to lift you up in prayer. I want to pray for you. If you've never started a relationship with Jesus Christ, you're on the outside looking in, listen, take that step of faith. Put your faith and trust in the God who already believes in you, already loves you, already proved it by going to the cross, taking your sin there. He wants to love you. He's a good, good Father. He loves you. He'll lift you up. He'll wash away your sin. He'll start something new on the inside of your life. All you have to do is call. You do it like this. Jesus, I need you in my life. Help me to be the man that I want to be for my wife, for my kids, for my family, for my neighbors. Lord, I pray that you just prepare the soil of my heart. Maybe you're a young man, maybe you're single, haven't started into this relationship of being a father yet. Listen, God wants to prepare the soil of your heart now. Be the man of God that He created you to be. Then you'll be able to be what you need to be for a young lady at the right time in God's kingdom and God's plan. Lord, thank you for what you're doing and across this nation. Thank you, Lord, for lifting up men today. I pray the blessing of God upon every father. Lord, I thank you for each one of us, Lord, who have had dads that have taught us something that's helped us be the dad that we are today or the man that we are today. We thank you for it. And we pray, Lord, that we would become spiritual fathers to young men who maybe are fatherless, to young boys or girls that need an example of what a godly father looks like. Lord, as Paul said, there are many leaders, but there aren't many fathers. Give us all a father's heart today. And Lord, pour out your blessing upon every household across this land. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, I want to point you to our website, alcindy.com. Leave us some comments if we can help you in any way. I know the Lord can use us to help encourage you along the journey that you're on. And hashtag Happy Father's Day or Dad. Put anything in there. If you live local, we'll make sure that you get a gift card. We get Mother's Day. Debbie gave out a lot of things. We're not drawing names, doing anything like that. If you're at church live with us Sunday, you're going to get a gift card. It'll be a blessing to you. But if you're in the area and you're tuning in, we'll be glad to just bless you. We love you. Just a reminder, God's got you, and you got this. Amen.